Dr. Ed Cole is the district superintendent, the DS, the bishop of the Eastern District of the Evangelical Free Church. His love for Jesus is so obvious in all that he does. He's a good friend of mine. He has sharpened me, challenged me, encouraged me, and has made my life all the richer. And so I just thank God for your passion for the Lord. And I'm encouraged to introduce for some and reintroduce to you for others, because some of you might know him already. But without any further ado, I'm going to ask for Pastor Ed Cole to come. Let's give him a warm welcome.
Thanks, man. Love you, buddy. All right. It's good to see everybody. How many of you were here last year when I was able to come to Integrity? Oh, a lot of you. Thank God. How many of you ladies were on the women's retreat that my wife was on? How many of you wish my wife were with me today? That would be me too. She was actually going to be here, but she got stuck. She flew from Harrisburg to Philadelphia, and then they wouldn't fly from Philadelphia to MacArthur Airport. So she stayed in the airport in Philadelphia for about 4 hours, and they put her back on the 24-minute flight back from Philadelphia to Harrisburg. So she said to say hello and give everybody her regards, but she'll be back with you next time. So sorry, I can't sing, and I'm nowhere near as good-looking as she is. Just hope she'll be able to get with us next time. I had an absolutely wonderful time with the students from Integrity, and I just have to tell you, it was such a breath of fresh air for me, being around students like that. Incredible. I've been praying for Integrity, and Pastor Tony knows this. I've been praying that Integrity would be what we call an epicenter church, which means it's like something like, you know, like on a map where the epicenter of an earthquake or whatever, it kind of spreads around. Well, in our district, we have about 40, we go from about halfway up the state of New York all the way down through the state of Virginia. We have about 42 to 43 million people we're trying to reach. And as you know, that's just absurd. And so what we're trying to do with God's help is to say, Lord, raise up some strong churches with some believers who believe you for the impossible. And Lord, we'll just trust you for that. And in doing that, I've been praying for Integrity Church that we'd have, this would be one of the churches that would just have just the gospel impact that would just multiply, multiply, multiply. When I was with the students this last couple of days, I got to tell you, I believe God's answering our prayers. I really do. You've got, not only do you have God at work in your students, you have God raising up leaders. In other words, they're not just being saved, which is primary, foundational, and coming into a relationship with Jesus and growing in that, but leaders are being raised up. Boys and girls are becoming men and women of God. And man, that's exciting stuff for me. And so what that means 5-10 years down the road, only God knows, but I'm going to believe him for some good stuff. And so anyway, you join with me in that prayer, but it's good to be with you today. I want to get in the word with you, and before I do, why don't you just bow your heads with me? Let's go to the Lord in prayer, and let's ask the Lord together, speak to our hearts, all right? Now, I want you to pray for me, if you don't mind. I'm going to give you about 10, 15 seconds of quiet to pray. Pray for me. I feel like I'm 100 years old today. Because I played touch football the last couple of days with these students, and I am a little tired and beaten up, and I really just want to be an empty vessel for the Lord to speak this morning. And I think those of you who are human understand what I mean. You know, you want to be what God wants you to be in that moment. So join with me in that prayer right now, and I'll pray for you as well. I'll close our time together. Father, it's a privilege to be with your children, an absolute privilege. Lord, I felt like I was at home with Integrity Church last year, the first time I had been here on a Sunday morning. Lord, I feel the same thing this morning. I just know that I'm with my people. Lord, we are yours, and we have what's most important in common. We may have no blood relationship, that we know of, but Lord, we know that by the blood of Jesus and by your love poured out on us, we are connected. By your Spirit, we are one. And Lord, as we worship you and we sit at your feet and open your word, Lord, we are one. I thank you for what you're doing with the students. I thank you and I praise you. And I pray that you'd raise up some men and women of God that would have fire in their belly to serve you. Lord, that they would be change agents for your glory. That they would bring the gospel of Jesus Christ wherever they go with them every single day. Lord, into their schools, into their homes. Bless them, Lord. Lord, thank you for every man and woman in this place right now. Lord, I have no doubt but that you have something to say to them. And I ask God, as I ask them to pray for me, that you would, even now, fill me with your Spirit. Let me only say what you want said. But Lord, even the things that I don't say, I pray by your Spirit, God, that you would speak to the hearts. And Lord, you say what needs to be said to every person in here today. I pray that chains of bondage would fall. I pray that freedom would be given. I pray that joy would replace heaviness. And I just pray, God, that if there's anyone in here today who does not know you, that they don't have the peace that they need to have with you, Lord, would you just change their hearts today? Give them the assurance that they're forgiven, that they have peace with you, and that heaven is their home. Lord God, bless them with that above all things. Lord, we give you praise. We give you thanks. Give us ears to hear what you'd have to say to us today. And most importantly, give us hearts to obey it. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Why don't you turn with me in your Bibles to Matthew chapter 28. Matthew chapter 28. We're going to look at the Great Commission. I've given the title, No Confusion Here. For the message. No confusion here. There should really be no confusion about what the church is to be about in our day. It really just shouldn't be that confusing. There's a little boy that lived out in the Midwest with his family. He's probably 10 or 11 years old, and he lived in Tornado Alley, and his dad had a radar and had the whole system thing. This is several years ago, but back before this was, you know, just common. Everybody had, you know, their notifications on their cell phones and everything telling you when bad weather's coming. Back before that, this man had something that was unique, and some of his neighbors were very thankful that he would share information with them. Well, this man found out from his radar and from his radio system that there was bad weather coming. In that part of the country, when there's a storm coming, you don't play around. You have every family has storm shelters, and they go underground. Well, this dad knew that the sighting of the storm, the tornado, was miles away. He knew that his son had time to get over there and to get back. He knew that was the case. Well, what ends up happening? He sends his little boy, it's a couple of football fields down the road, sends his little boy, go tell the Smith family that there's a storm coming, they need to watch and be ready just in case. So the little boy goes out, and a few minutes later, the storm starts coming. Well, this man has, you know, other children, and he has a wife, so when the storm starts coming, he's recognizing it's coming quickly. So he's thinking, okay, well, I don't know where my other son is that I sent out, but I got to get my family under, you know, in the storm shelter. So he grabs his other kids, he grabs his wife, and all they can do is just pray. He's like, I don't know where the boy is. Well, the boy comes running in before the storm hits, and when he comes down there, he's shaking and he's got blood on his hands. And the dad just gives him a hug and he says, where have you been? And he says, Daddy, there was a bird up in a tree, and I started throwing rocks at the bird. And he said, I ended up hitting the bird, and the bird fell down, and so I picked it up, and that blood is the bird's blood. The dad gave the little boy a hug, and he walked away. He didn't want to put any guilt on the little boy, but he sat down beside his wife, and he said, that blood is really the Smith's blood. Because the boy had a message that he was to deliver to the Smith family that a storm was coming, a tornado was coming, and the tornado did come. But the boy didn't give the message. And so the dad's just fearful that when he gets out of the storm shelter that he's going to go down the road and find that the Smith family wasn't prepared. Now, I just give that to you as an illustration. Whether or not it happened, I have actually no idea. But a preacher told it one time, and I said, man, that's a scary story. It works pretty good. But you get the picture, right? Little boy had a message, and he didn't deliver the message. I want you to know today that the church has a message and we have a mission. And there should be no confusion about our mission. I love the fact that you guys are getting ready to do this Bible study. As a matter of fact, I'd kind of like to do the Bible study myself. I think that woman can preach. But how many of you know that while Bible study is a good part of what the church should be about, that's not essentially the mission of the church? Just to do Bible studies. Bible studies are a part of it, a necessary part of it, a valuable part of it, but it's not the end goal of it. We want people to come to church on Sunday morning and have a good service. We want them to leave having learned something and getting good information, and we want them to feel better and have hope. But how many of you know that the church is not here just to make people feel better? We're not here to just make people feel better. We're not here to just do more studies. We're here to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. We're here to share the hope that is found in Jesus Christ and in Jesus alone. And please understand me, there are churches across this country that today are diving in headfirst to all kinds of things that are delightful distractions. But they're distractions nonetheless. We've got a message to share, and it's the gospel of Jesus Christ. There should be no confusion. We have what God wants for us in the Great Commission. And here's the Great Commission, Matthew chapter 28. At the end of the Gospel of Matthew, Matthew writes this gospel and closes it with these words that Jesus gave to his closest disciples. He goes up on a mountain. This is after his resurrection. And he's shown himself to them. It says some are doubting it, but Jesus draws them up there. Verse 18, and he says to them, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I'm with you always, even to the end of the age. That's the Great Commission. Now, here's how I'm going to break down the message. Now, I'm going to tell you this. It's three words that start with the letter A. The first one is authority. And that's where the bulk of our message is going to be spent this morning. Authority. Because that right there is going to be the launch pad for us to go out and to share this message that we have. We need to believe in the authority that Jesus has. Secondly, anointing. I don't know if you know what anointing means, but I'll explain that in just a few minutes. But anointing. And then thirdly, action. So let's begin with authority. The Gospel of Matthew was written so that readers, not only today, but way back then, could read this story and know that Jesus is a real person, that he has lived. He's been born. He lived in real time. But he is unlike other people in that he is the divine-born Son of God. Matthew opens his gospel with all the begats. He gives the genealogy and he traces it back so far. This one begat that one begat that one. And he goes through all this genealogy, which was important, really important to them back then. And he gets to the end of that. And then he takes us into a little bit of Jesus' early, his public life, and takes us into that ministry. So he gets to Matthew chapter 4. in Matthew chapter 4, he starts to roll out this thing that reveals to the reader the authority that Jesus is speaking of. Because remember, Jesus says in Matthew 28:18, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Now, please understand, Jesus is eternal in nature. He was with God at creation. He always has been. But part of the Father's plan, based upon creating a world that would experience a fall and a separation and would be imperfect, was that He would redeem this fallen world. And the means of redeeming this fallen world and bringing it back to Himself was that Jesus would come. His Son would come. And so Jesus was essentially born of a woman. We all know the Virgin Mary from around New York. We've all at least heard of Mary. Now, Mary gave birth to a bouncing baby boy named Jesus, and she was married to a guy named Joseph, but Joseph wasn't the father. The father was God. He was conceived of the Holy Spirit, born. He was raised, and he was like us in every way. He was hungry, he was thirsty, he cried, etc., etc. Like us in every way, but he knew no sin. Matthew chapter 4, you see Jesus doing battle with the devil. And he does what Adam and Eve, way back at the beginning of the Bible, could not do. When they were tempted, when Satan came and tried to trip them up, they were like, okay, here's some good-looking fruit, and it would be good for you to eat it. What do? They eat it. And so that started all the mess. Well, Jesus was confronted by Satan, not tempted once, but three times, world, flesh, devil. He's tempted, but unlike Adam and Eve, he overcomes. He immediately starts his ministry. After the baptism of John, he goes away and he goes up. He does battle with Satan and he comes down showing, I am unlike any human that's ever lived. I have looked at Satan face to face with the best he could give and I beat him. Matthew chapters 5 through 7, Jesus shows his authority in his teaching. He gives the Sermon on the Mount. By the time he gets to the end of that, they know this guy is, he's taking Old Testament stuff and he's making it, like he's showing them how it's fulfilled now. He's like, he's filling it out. And when the people are hearing this, they're like, this guy is a revolutionary teacher. And so by the end of Matthew chapter 7, the writer says that he was unlike any of the scribes or the religious leaders of the day. They live like academics and preachers do today. They're quoting this guy and that guy, and they're quoting this rabbi. But Jesus comes, and at the end of Matthew 7, the scriptures teach us that they said of him, he teaches unlike anybody that's ever lived. He teaches as one who has his own innate authority. Matthew chapter 8. I want to enjoy this with you. Turn over to Matthew 8 with me. There are two chapters here, or scroll, whatever it is that you do. You may have your phone and you're scrolling down. Whatever it is that you do, you don't want to miss this. Don't worry, by the way, I'm not going to preach all of the Gospel of Matthew. All right? I'm not going to keep you here past 3 p.m. today. So here we go, Matthew chapter 8. Remember, Matthew is writing to show the authority that Jesus has. All authority has been given to me. I'll come back to that in just a second. But for right now, watch this authority that Matthew is writing about being worked out in his gospel as he's telling the story. Jesus, Matthew chapter 8, comes upon a crowd. There's all kinds of crowds of people following him. And there's a leper that comes to him and kneels before him. Lord, if you will, you can make me clean. What does Jesus do? He does the unthinkable. He actually reaches out his hand and he touches him. He says, I will be clean. Now, let me tell you the significance of that. It's not in Matthew's gospel, but the significance of that, if you go back and read in the Old Testament, you don't touch people with lepers. They're ceremonially unclean. As a matter of fact, there were many times and many examples that they were to announce the fact that they had leprosy. Unclean, unclean. Yet when Jesus comes upon this leper, you know what he does? This guy who would have made him unclean, nobody touches a leper because that limits your ability to worship. What does Jesus do? He just reaches out and touches him. And rather than Jesus being made unclean, what happens? The leper becomes clean. You go on and it continues. There's a guy there who's a centurion. He's a guard. He's a worker for Rome, a Gentile nonetheless. And he comes up to Jesus knowing about, I don't even know how he got to know all about him. I guess he heard about it, but he comes up and he says, Jesus, my servant is lying paralyzed at home and he's suffering. And Jesus says, I'll come and heal him. But this centurion says, Lord, I understand authority. I am one who is under authority and I have others who are under my authority. And I know that you have authority to just speak the word. You don't even have to go. Just speak the word. And at the power of your word, my servant will be healed. This was the kind of faith that even Jesus says, it says he marveled at that kind of faith because this centurion knew the authority that Jesus had. Absolutely amazing. And then you go through and you look and you see further on that Jesus goes into Peter's house, one of his followers. He goes in there and Peter's mother-in-law is lying in there sick with a fever. What does Jesus do? Does he avoid her? Just reaches out and touches her. When they find out that there's a healer in the land, they're crowding the whole house. They bring people who are oppressed by demons. He casts out spirits. He heals sick people. He gives them a message about following him. And then they get tired. He spent the whole day with these people and they're all around him. You could imagine. Jesus says, let's get in a boat. We're going to go to another town now. They get in the boat. And here they are out on the water. And Jesus falls asleep in a boat. Terrible storm hits the water. And they say the storms on the waters over there. I'm going to Israel the first time this fall. I cannot wait. But I hear even to this day on some of the bodies of water over there, when a storm hits, it's fast and it's furious. Well, this is one of those bodies of water, and they go and they wake up Jesus. They say, we're taking on water. Aren't you afraid? Don't you care that we're about to die? Jesus says, oh, ye of little faith. Jesus stands up and he speaks calmness and peace to the winds and the waves. Wind, wave, be still. It's really kind of crazy because the wind stops, the wave stops, and these guys who are afraid saying, don't you care that we're about to die? Now all the fear they had for nature, they now have for the one that's in the boat with them. They're afraid that what's outside the boat's going to kill them. Now they're afraid that what's inside the boat could do even more. Talk about authority. Now, again, in the Bible, you don't know this, but you know, in the culture of the day, to be out on water like that, there's a lot of suspicion that evil spirits linger out on the water. What this is Jesus having authority over nature, over any evil spirit, over any suspicion, over sickness, over disease. Jesus has authority. You go a little bit further. Jesus walks into a place where there's, out in the Gadarenes, there are demons that are out there and a couple of guys. And these demons, Jesus doesn't even confront them. They go up and they're like, Jesus, why have you come to torment us? The demons recognized who he was. They recognized his authority. They're like, would you just tell us to go here? Jesus has authority and says, leave them and go there. He has authority over evil. He has authority. It is absolutely amazing what Jesus can do to transform a situation. He goes into another place. There's a paralytic there. They bring the paralytic out there, Matthew chapter 9. And they bring him out there lying on a cot. And Jesus says, take heart, my son, your sins are forgiven. They start questioning among themselves, who is this guy that thinks he can forgive sins? Only God can do that. Jesus says, is it easier for me to say your sins are forgiven or to say you rise? He says, okay, just so that you understand the authority that I have, rise and walk. What he's doing is he's showing these people who are questioning, who does this guy think he is? Here's what he's doing with his actions. I'm the Son of God. I have authority to forgive sins and I have authority to heal diseases. In addition, it just goes on. This will be the last one. But the guy that actually is writing the Gospel of Matthew, his name was Levi. He's sitting in a tax collecting booth outside town. And I want you to understand, tax collectors were the kind of people that everybody wanted to avoid back then. These were like bona fide thugs. I mean, we want to avoid tax collectors today. No offense if you work for the CIA or anything, or the IRS. We want to avoid the tax collectors. But we do understand thuggery, do we not? Now, if you all get with me, I preach fast, I promise you. But if you don't respond, I'll be needy up here. Some of you are still looking at me like, go on. I'm going. What I want you to see is that there's this guy out there, because the tax collectors, they worked for Rome. There were Jewish people who worked for Rome, and they're taking taxes. But they were notorious. Notorious for not just taking the taxes that they were supposed to take, but taking more. They weren't just wanting to pay Rome, they were wanting to pad their own pockets. And Levi was one of those guys. He was a bona fide thug. They could do this with Roman guards behind them. And so that's why people didn't like them. But lo and behold, when everybody else is avoiding the thug, who does Jesus go and find? Yeah. And Jesus goes to him and he says, come and follow me. And here's this guy, Matthew. He gets up and he goes and he follows Jesus. He says, we're going to throw a party at my house. Great. Your mom and dad tell you to avoid these parties. They say, don't go. Don't hang out with them. You lay down with dogs. You get up with fleas. Show me your friends and I'll show you your future. We've all said these kind of things, or we've heard them. You don't go to this place. And the Bible tells us that there were many notorious sinners. They were tax collectors and prostitutes in Levi's house. But what did Jesus do? Jesus went into that room, and instead of him becoming like them and getting tempted to sin, Jesus goes into that room and he lifts them up. He changes Levi. He's the one that wrote the gospel that we're reading today. Because here's why. None of us can change a person's heart, but God can. Amen. He can give them a new heart. And that's what this gospel is about. He has authority. He changes things. He has authority over death. Absolutely crazy. How many of you are wearing a cross today around your neck? It's amazing. If you would have told anyone in the first century back then that we would be wearing crosses around our necks one day, they would say, what? It's like us wearing a noose around our neck today. Or an electric chair, something like that. You've probably, those of you that have been around church for a while, you've probably heard that. But it's bizarre. But why do we do this? You see, Jesus was hanging between two thieves, virtually naked right there in public between these two thieves. He's mocked, he's beaten, he's bloodied. Why is this something that we wear around our necks? The Romans killed people by the thousands on these crosses, and we're wearing this in gold around our neck. Are we crazy? Here's why. It says, the song says, it is the emblem of suffering and shame that gives us life. It is his death on the cross that provided me eternal life. Amen. He took my beating and he took yours. He shed his blood so that we wouldn't have to shed ours. He was separated temporarily from the Father so that you and I could live in such a way that we would never be separated from the Father. He bore all of our shame, all of our pain on the cross. And so today we look at the cross and say, this is my hope. This is life for me. This is why we say with the Apostle Paul, we preach Christ and him crucified. Wow. He transformed it. What in the world? He transformed death. How in the world did he transform death? Think about it. If you're in here today and you're not a believer, you're like, okay, we're going somewhere, but now you're really getting there. We Christians, you guys know that to an unbelieving, completely naturalistic mind, we've got a screw loose somewhere. You understand this, right? We when someone dies that we know is in the faith, that's been living for Jesus, that's been worshiping Jesus, what do we say? To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. Amen. They're in a better place now. What? Praise God. We go to a funeral. You ever been to those funerals where you get there and it turns out to be a worship service? Where somebody on the front row, they start singing songs and they raise their hand. You're like, weren't you related to this person? What are you smiling about? What they're smiling about is that there are no more sinuses for them. There's no more suffering. No more fighting and losing with sin. No more cancer. No more defeat. No more anger. No more battling addiction. Free. Free as they've ever been. And we look at death and we say, death is not the end for us. It's only a new beginning. And we mean it. We say death is not goodbye because Christ has made it to where we say, when we meet again, it's just going to be good morning. This is where it all begins for us. He's transformed life. He's transformed death. Death itself has been defeated. Oh, death, where is thy sting? Oh, grave, where is thy victory? It's been swallowed up through Christ Jesus our Lord. And so he says at the end of Matthew, I have lived in such a way I never sin. I've defeated every foe that's ever come at me. And so I reign over this planet, not just as its creator, but its king. And I have authority even over hell itself. It's fighting. Hell's fighting. Satan's fighting. But please know this, Christ has won the battle. And one day all these little skirmishes will be over. And the battle will be won. All authority, he says, has been given me in heaven and on earth. Oh my gracious. We should embrace his authority and rejoice over his authority. And that takes us to the second thing that he says. All authority, it's been given to me. He says, looking into the eyes of his disciples, go therefore. This is the anointing. Go therefore and make disciples. What does that mean? Make disciples, make converts. Tell them what I've come to do. Tell them the life I've come to give. Tell them that if they follow me, they can experience this victory. They can experience this peace, this forgiveness. Tell them that. Tell them how they can live for me and be blessed by me. That's what discipleship is. Teach them that when they obey me, I'm not a taskmaster, I'm a father. You disciples, this is your message. This is what you're anointed for. Anointing, can I explain it just quickly? The anointing, they poured oil over the heads of priests. It was symbolic. You're set apart for a purpose. They poured oil over kings. You're set apart for a purpose. When he says, go therefore, later on, he's going to pour out the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit is poured out. And that anointing that is spoken here is filled right there in Acts chapter 2. And when we believe, we receive the Holy Spirit. And guess what? In that moment, we have been anointed. You say, I don't feel anointed. I don't always feel anointed either, but I am. Hallelujah. And the way that I know that is because of the third A, action. He says, this is so powerful. Are you all with me? Yes. Just sense his presence so powerful right now. He says to them, and lo, I will be with you always, even to the end of the age. What he's saying to them is, as you go and as you do this, you're not alone. And you'll see that I'm with you when you act on what I'm giving you. You don't see that I'm with you in my power by sitting in your living room or just by sitting in the pews in a church. You see that I'm with you when you're going with my gospel. When you're going and sharing this wonderful, powerful message, this hope that God has come and that he's given hope to the world, that he can save the worst thug. He can save religious people and irreligious people. He can forgive everyone. And you'll only know it when you go with the gospel. Are you with me? There's hope. Why? Because he can transform any situation. He has complete power. Sometimes somebody will say to you, oh, that person will never. You say, that is from hell. I rebuke that. I resist that. I reject it. My God can change any situation. And I see it, I know it, I've experienced it. Praise his name. Band, would you get ready to close us in song? Wow, nose is runny. I don't blow my nose in public. I'm just going to sniffle, and sorry if that... Thank you anyway, it's really sweet. My nose clean, my wife's not here. I hate to quench the spirit in a very sensitive moment right there, but my wife says the true friendship test is if you'll tell somebody when they've got something on their nose. Since she's not here, honey, you'll have to tell me. You'll only see the power of the gospel when you share it. Your neighbor, your coworker, your child, it's running, your uncle, your mom, your dad, your thug, that he has authority. What do? You don't debate with them. You love them. And you share Jesus with them. Get to Jesus fast and tell them your story. They know you're imperfect. You don't have to hide that. I'm a mess. He's still working on me. That's just being honest, right? Amen. So I'm not preaching at someone like I got it all together, and it, hopefully you will too. You sense his power when you share with them what Jesus has come to do for us, what we can't do for ourselves, which is to give us peace with God and to live that out every day. I'm closing with this. There was a guy I was talking to one day. I found out about halfway into our conversation that he had an MBA from Harvard. Now, I grew up in East Tennessee. Now, some of you with East Tennessee, you get a picture in your mind that we all play banjos and walk around barefoot. It's not that bad. There are intelligent people there, very intelligent people there. I'm somewhere in between the two spectrums of very intelligent and that. But so I'm in there, but when you like, just being very sincere, when you tell me somebody's got an MBA from Harvard, I'm glad I didn't find out before the conversation, because I probably would have like been nervous and stuff. Instead, I was talking with him and as we were talking, what ends up happening is that I just shared with him. He's asking me questions. He's got money. He's got a plane. He travels the world. And he's asking me all these questions, and some of which I could give no answer to. And he knew that I was a pastor. And so I end up saying to him, I said, listen, I said, man, I Can I just share with you my story? I shared with him the gospel. He's saying, I just don't think Jesus is the only way. And I was like, well, here's the thing. I said, Jesus, I said this before I knew he had the MBA from Harvard. I said, brother, I said, I just think you haven't thought this out thoroughly. He said, what do you mean? So I shared with him John 14:6, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father except by me. And I said, Jesus is either liar, lunatic, or Lord. He hadn't read C.S. Lewis, so he thought I was brilliant at that point. I'm giving him early stuff, you know, stuff anybody that's read some of these books can. And so, but it's ministering to him, and I can see God's really got him, and he's a really nice man. Further in the conversation, I'm not getting through, and I said, can I just share with you a story? I said, when I was in junior high school, I was raised by a good mom and dad. They loved me. My mom tried to take us to church. We weren't getting it. My dad grew up without a dad, and he grew up in a pretty rough home, and he went to Vietnam, and things were tough, and he, you know, alcohol is an issue. Talk about a violent background. You do the math on this scenario here. I'd never been to church with my dad before. He came with me when I was in junior high. When I was in junior high, however, my dad came home one Sunday morning, said, everybody get up. We're going to church. We go to church. I said, I'm going to tell you, that day, God gave me a new dad. We left the church that day. We walked up the street where we lived. He took bottles of alcohol I didn't even know he had, poured them down the drain. And God gave me a new dad that day. I said, unfortunately, I was already wanting to be like my old dad. So I lived that way for the next several years till I was 20 years of age. I was in trouble in high school, went through the Marine Corps. It only got worse, only got a little more attitude with it. I went to church with my mom after she keeps inviting me. This preacher preaches, and he preaches a message entitled, How to Go to Hell with a Positive Attitude. I told Neil, I said, Neil, I was so mad because I thought he was talking to me. I said, I thought my mother had spoken with him about me. And I said, it was like God was just talking to me. And then he said at the end of it, it's not about religion. It's not about you getting it together. He said, it's about Jesus coming to save sinners. It's about him doing for you what you can't do. And I said, that night I gave my life to Jesus, and I said, the truth is I've messed up a gazillion times since then. But that night he gave me a new heart, and I've had peace with God. I said, he changed me. And do you know something? While I was talking to Neil, he had this big smile on his face, but tears just started going down his face. And so here's me watching the power of God and the power of the gospel, the power, the authority that he has working on this man, this brilliant man's heart. And here I am, East Tennessee hillbilly, sharing something with him. But I'm going to tell you, I'd rather have a fifth grade education with the power of the Holy Spirit and the presence of God than I would with all the degrees in the world. I love education. I'm a very educated man, but nothing is more powerful than the gospel of Jesus Christ. Church, let there be no confusion about the Great Commission. That's why we're here. Let's share the hope of Jesus Christ as a church and individually. That's our privilege and it's our call. Let's pray. Father, in Jesus' name right now, I just want to pray if there's anyone in here who doesn't know you, that they would know today Jesus is Lord. He's come to seek and save them. I believe that I've preached the gospel mostly to church people, but Lord, if there's somebody here today who needs to give their heart to you, Lord, would you just give them a new heart right now? With all heads bowed and all eyes closed, I don't do this very often, but I want to give you an invitation. If you've never received Christ as your Lord and Savior, talk to him right now. Talk to him right now. Confess to him that you're tired of living without him, that you want his peace, you want his forgiveness, and you're turning from life without him, and you're turning to him. Do it right now. If you don't know how, pray something like this with me. There's no magic about my words. It's got to be from your heart, but pray this, something like it anyway. Dear God, I believe you're here today and you're speaking to me. I'm sorry for living without you. in my life as a Savior and as a best friend when you've offered it. I'm sorry. And today I turn and I give you my life. Please forgive me. Come into my heart. Save me from myself. Save me from sin. And help me to live for you from this point forward. I worship you. I believe Jesus came for me. And today I want to determine to live for you. To live for Jesus in the power of the Spirit. If anybody just prayed that prayer, would you just let me know? Raise your hand right now. I didn't plan on doing this coming in here today. Praise God. Praise God. There are three or four of you. Can I just tell you at the end of the service when everybody else is dismissed, I would love to talk with you for 2 minutes. I'm going to ask you, those of you that raised your hand, to come up and talk to me and Pastor Tony up here at the front. We're going to dismiss in about 4 or 5 minutes. But when we dismiss, I would love to talk with you and pray with you. But I just want you to know you're the reason that this church is here. You're the reason this church is here so that people would know Jesus Christ. Father, in Jesus' name, I praise you. And I thank you for the life that I see and have sensed with Integrity Church. I thank you for your power, for your gospel. I thank you that you're here with us today. We worship you. May this church be clear about the Great Commission. May we embrace it. Corporately and individually, I pray for new boldness and new clarity for every believer in this room. In Jesus' name, amen.